Here I'm going to demonstrate installation of pfSense on a 10Zig thin client. First, access the BIOS firmware options. Hammer the escape key to get into these. The password you'll need is 10Zig, all one word, capitals and numbers. I like to use Baytrail Intels for my thin clients, they're very affordable. Being 2013 chips and thin clients, the partitioning scheme defaults to legacy, which is for MBR disks, that's master boot record disks. You can tell it is the default here because the clock has reset to 2014, hence volatile memory has not been preserved. The CR2032 batteries died. MBR stroke legacy can still work, but the USB stick I'm installing from is GPT formatted, and I'd prefer it if my OS disks use GPT also. With that set, I don't even need to select boot device. There's only one GPT stroke UFI device attached, and it's the pfSense installer. Incidentally, I burnt my USB stick with Rufus. pfSense boot messages scrolled across the screen. I've censored the bits containing my MAC addresses. The question about partitioning throws me. I'd heard good things about ZFS, but dislike being an early adopter, stroke guinea pig. It's of most benefit for multiple disk environments, which would in itself make it pretty hard to recommend for pfSense. It's also more resilient to unexpected power cuts, but I imagine UFS has been patched in that respect since those observations were first made. Plus, I never get power cuts on the grid here these days. I do pull the power cord, which is what it's designed to protect against, and I don't mean literally pull the power cord, I just mean hold the power button. But I would pull the power cord if that didn't work. Otherwise I concede and plug in a monitor and keyboard and shut it down that way. UFS it is. I use the entire disk rather than a partition. The default partitions look good. It's not worth fiddling with. It might have a swap space, but with 8GB of RAM it's not going to need it. Installation is much faster than for a full fat distribution like Ubuntu server. After installation, the next boot will ask us how it should configure the networking. The installation can actually occur offline, if you have a more convenient keyboard and monitor set up away from the network. Technically, you can do the reboot offline and find if pfSense is detecting your Ethernet adapters. In this video, I'm doing it online because A, I want to use the web configurator. That's the web interface we use to access the router after installation over the LAN. And B, first boot prompts us for the necessary information without having to hunt for it through the menu the router UI pauses at. It asks for the LAN interface device, whether to configure VLANs now, and the WAN interface device. Here you can see I don't have the option to use my USB device, UGen 0.4 / UGen 0.5 for WAN. These are some messages caused by me replacing that USB device with its big brother. It sees a URE0, which eventually gets mapped to UE0, but is not recognised, so I decide to reboot by hitting the power button. We could do all this offline and test our USB sticks for recognition by pfSense before moving to the networked area. You can't access the web configurator until devices can connect, at least over the internal network. It's the external MAC address I should be redacting here. On this reboot we see that both network cards are detected and pfSense's running interface assignment option. Both RE0 and UE0 are now up, and I'm being asked three questions. Configure VLANs, the WAN name, the LAN name. I confirm my answers to proceed, and UE0 gets reset. At last we see the default pfSense local menu. What's even better is seeing that the old WAN IPv4 address that the Sky router had negotiated is found and being used. We will lose this address and not be able to renew if we don't send certain DHCP options. I'll show you these options using the web configurator interface shortly. I'm not sure it's possible via command line. First, I run a few tests here, because the web configurator might not always be available. I'm here at the terminal, so I run some tests to check status. I ping DNS, that's 8.8.8.8, This tests if I can get past the ISP's gateway, at least a ping. Next, I ping google.com, which tests name resolution on the WAN. I test bbc.co.uk as well, because 8.8.8.8 is Google DNS, so they might be biased. These are the two main services I should be testing for internet connectivity, as I get an IP address and can resolve names. If they work on the WAN, then any failure to get them working on my internal network is a fault with router or client configuration. Often stale records will play a part here. I could reboot and go and use the web configurator now, but I know the first time I did this I didn't have an IP address on the WAN. I wanted to use the second option here in the pfSense textual menu to be sure I was requesting an IP address there. You can see pfSense already does this in the two all-important lines above the menu options. WAN is marked V4DHCP4 and has a /22 CIDR range. What you will want option 2 for is changing the LAN subnet. This is more useful for larger networks, but can be a useful security measure in a home network. Changing defaults is good for security, but bad for administrative overhead. I make it 172.17.1.1/24. I want my LAN to not overlap with other VLANs, so I give it only 255 addresses. I reserve the first two for the network and gateway, and last one for broadcast. That leaves 253 remaining client IP addresses. Let's hop on over to my Ubuntu clients and inspect the network there. IPA tells me I still have an address from the previous DHCP server in the 192.168 range. I release and renew to get 172.17.1.3. This proves the DHCP server is working. Let's use a browser to see the web configurator. The default is used HTTPS. It adds a bit of encryption in case your private LAN gets compromised. If your private LAN's compromised, you're going to need stronger security anyway. Accept the self-signed certificate and log into the portal. The default credentials are admin and pfSense. We begin with the setup wizard. Give the domain a globally unique name, or at least try since you can't be sure it will remain or even be initially globally unique. Here in step 2 it asks for the DNS server. By default it queries root DNS servers, which is fine. In step 3 accept the defaults. Step 4 depends on your ISP. I'm demonstrating Sky Broadband here. This is based on BT networks, which uses what is shown as WAN-OE. That's WAN over Ethernet. Select the HCP for interface type here. Step 5 we can leave as default. If we hadn't run option 2 from the pfSense text terminal, we could change the subnet here. That would require more messing with clients' DHCP release renew commands. Step 6 wants me to enter an admin password twice. I presume this is to change from the default. We get congratulations, and to celebrate I explore the dashboard. Interfaces is useful information. We still have addresses, though I doubt the WANs will persist, not without setting DHCP options first. Both are green and up, but I didn't use the IPv6 on the LAN. We can run even more tests from the web configurator interface than we could when using the physical keyboard and monitor attached to the router. I run the same bunch of pings, only for now. The WAN interface is what we must configure for Sky Broadband. This information is available from an opnSense post, but not from pfSense, where the box names and menu hierarchies are a little different. Least requirements and requests, send options must be set to DHCP client identifier, open quotes, something at SkyDSL, pipe, anything, close quotes. pfSense pretty much holds our hand from here, as we've done everything required to maintain a connection to Sky's ISP. Check routes. Check gateways. The default monitor is the Sky gateway. For whatever reason, that isn't responding to our pings, and this looks bad here. The gateway and connection should still work, but we can change the monitor ISP to something like 8.8.8.8 for accurate monitoring. Save changes takes us back to the gateway overview, where it's reminding us to apply changes. I postpone that and go to status, gateways, where I refresh and see the changes had already applied. Related settings takes me back to where the changes say they still need applying. Instead, we'll try to fix IPv6. It's a fool's errand. It doesn't accept the 8.8.8.8 I provide. I find the correct IPv6 address for Google DNS and paste that in. Save. Only now do I apply changes. Now the DHCP6 address is perpetually pending. The clients should have full internet access now. Mine didn't. And it's probably something to do with DNS. Sky took back their IP address for a while too. By the following day, leases and DNS had a chance to resolve. This shows data volumes in and out. You can see the WAN connection is less than 1 kilobyte a second. The LAN connection is slightly more. This is fine. Full service restored. Her latency though, 6 milliseconds, it's probably random, but it's far lower than what I remember from the Sky Router. Traffic graphs show 10 megabytes per second download and 2.5 megabytes per second upload.